Good morning, church, and welcome. We are so glad that you are here this morning. Let's all stand together and worship.
Thank you.
Let's continue our worship and sing out this next song. I search the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures the faith. Never enough. Then you came along and put me back together. Now every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's
Good morning, church family. My name is Laura Tatum. I'm a member here at the church at Avenue South, and I'm involved with our college ministry here. As we transition into our time of prayer, I first just want to say thanks for being here. One of the greatest battles is simply showing up, and we definitely do not take it lightly that you have taken time out of your day to be here and to meet with the Lord and to be encouraged and worship Him. I want to read you a passage that I read this week. I was spending time with the Lord, and this was just particularly striking. It's from Psalm 18, verses 31 through 35. For who is God but the Lord? And who is a rock except our God? The God who equipped me with strength and made my way blameless. He made my feet like the feet of a deer and set me secure on the heights. He trains my hands for war so that my arms can bend a bow of bronze. You have given me the shield of your salvation, and your right hand supported me, and your gentleness made me great. It's an interesting thing about God, how he is both the God who trained David's hands for war, but he's also the God whose gentleness made David great. So as we move into our time of prayer, I want you to consider the fullness of God, the way that he is all in all. What do you need from him today? You know it's okay to be needy for the Lord, right? It's okay. In fact, you were created to need God. What do you need from him? Do you need comfort, conviction, a softened heart? Are you in, maybe you're in a season of great faith, or maybe you feel like this season is nothing but a drought, and you just need a drink of water. What do you need? If God were to sit in front of you and ask you, "What do you need from me?" what would you tell him? You know, when Jesus tells us in Matthew 11 to come to him, and when he asks us to abide in John 15, he's not asking us to mop the floors. He's telling us to sit down at the table and feast. So, church family, what do you need from Jesus today? Let's sit down at the table and talk to our good shepherd who has invited us to come to him. Beloved, Jesus is here and he wants to hear from you. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you and bow before you humbly. Lord, we thank you that you are both the holy, holy, holy Lord, but you are also our Father. Lord, I thank you that you will not do us wrong, that you will not lead us astray. Lord, for anyone here who hasn't asked you for what they need, would you give them the courage and the faith to ask? For the people here who maybe they don't know what they need, would you do what only you can do and provide for us in ways that are far beyond our imagination? Lord Jesus, I thank you that you set a table before us in the presence of our enemies. I thank you that you anoint our heads with oil, and we praise you for our cups run over. I thank you that surely goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives. And I thank you that one day we shall dwell in your house forever. We'll be home. Remind us of our true citizenship. Remind us of home. Now to you who is able to keep us from stumbling and to present us blameless before the presence of your glory with great joy. To you, the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority for all time and now and forever. In your name, Jesus, I pray. Amen.
Good morning, church family. I am so grateful that you're here this morning. And if you have a Bible with you, let me encourage you to turn to 1 Timothy in the New Testament, the Apostle Paul's letter to a young brother in Christ named Timothy. While you're doing that, let me share with you that one of the exciting and encouraging things about being a pastor here in Nashville is how many churches are doing great work in the community. And listen, you guys know my heart on this. I've mentioned it several times. I believe there's tons of church properties and facilities in Davidson County. I think Nashville in that way might be over-churched. However, it's my conviction we are under-gospeled. Like, we are under-gospeled. And even if there are a lot of churches doing really good gospel ministry, there are hundreds of thousands of people moving to our city every 2 to 5 years. We've never needed every church who believes the scriptures and preaches Jesus to be more healthy and more effective than ever before. And I had a cup of coffee this week with Elliot Cherry, who's the pastor at Midtown Fellowship Church on 12th, a good friend of mine. Grateful for him and his friendship. We've known each other for years. And as we were sitting there meeting, I told him, Elliot, I pray for you. I pray for your church. And that's one of the things we're going to do this morning. We're going to continue to pray. So please pray just that everybody would continue that lives and is a part of a church in Nashville, live out the gospel so that people can meet Jesus. So hey, before we dig in, let me just pray for that sweet congregation and my brother. God, thank you for the gospel of Jesus Christ. Please continue to raise up churches and women and men to serve and lead in the city of Nashville in a way where we can reach people who do not know you. I pray for my brother Elliot. I thank you for his friendship and his ministry. Give him greater influence with the gospel. We pray for our church and their church to continue to grow in friendship. Pray for their congregation, Lord. We pray for their spiritual protection, for their flourishing. And Lord, we pray for all the churches in the city of Nashville who love you and believe your word to be faithful and to be healthy and to be strong for your glory and for the joy of your church. And we pray this in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen, amen, amen. Well, hey, listen, as we open up scripture today for a brand new sermon series throughout the book or the letter from Paul to his young disciple, young pastor friend, Timothy, one of the questions I want to ask you this morning is, do you have any regrets? Do you have any regrets? And listen, don't go too far down that rabbit hole, okay? I don't want anybody to get discouraged. I don't want anybody to think too hard about that. But I saw a bumper sticker or something that said, like, life is living, moving forward without any regrets. And to be quite honest with you, like, we've all done things or we've all made choices or our inactivity made choices that we wish we had done differently. And I can remember When I was in high school, our youth pastor came up and he said, you're a big guy. When you walk into the room, people look to you. So that's who you are. But you're also a follower of Jesus. And we really need you to be involved in our student ministry and to be a leader. And I was just so busy with sports and trying to make good grades that I just kind of declined that. You know, when I got to college, kind of same deal. The coaching staff where I played football, Christian University, they were like, listen, you're a big guy. Sound familiar? When you walk in a room, people look at you. You love Jesus. Like, people need to hear about Jesus. And sometimes coaches or teachers can't reach a student or a player, but you might. And I'll be honest with you, it wasn't until the end of my collegiate years where I really gave my heart to the Lord and surrendered to a call to ministry. But when I look back, I can't believe, like, God had blessed me with influence and leadership, and he had given me talents and abilities that I could have used, and I just tapped out. I was too busy. I meant well, but I was focused on other things. I tell you what was great, though. When the Lord got a hold of my heart at about 22 years old, I decided it's never too late to be the man or woman of Christ you might have been this side of heaven. And I decided to steward and be as best I can, God helping me, a good manager of every bit of influence, resources, my time, my talents, and treasures that God gave me from that moment forward. Now, I haven't been perfect with that, as you might imagine, but I want to ask you this question. What are you doing with your time, your talents, and your treasures? What are you doing with the influence God's given you? Because if I could be that youth pastor, if I could be that football coach looking at you to say, there is so much about your life and God's work in you that you could make an impact, you could make a difference, what are you doing with that? For some of us, we'd say, I think I'm doing that. I think I'm doing well. I think I'm being faithful. Well, good for you. Like, this is a time to recommit to using every bit of yourself, whole life, to being a faithful steward and manager of what God's given you. For others of us, it may be a sobering, convicting moment. You know what? I need to get serious about that. I need to be focused on what matters most. I don't want to squander this. And when I'm 30 or 40 or 80, look back and say, what if? And it's with that intentionality, like a positive and encouraging, kind of fatherly to a young man perspective, that Paul gives these words to the church at Avenue South. So let me invite you to stand with me in honor of God's word. Hear this as an encouragement. Hear this as an admonition of somebody who wants God's best for you. And this is exactly what Paul said to Timothy and the church in Ephesus and also to the church at Avenue South. 1 Timothy 6, verse 17. Instruct those who are rich in the present age not to be arrogant or to set their hope on the uncertainty of wealth, but on God who richly provides us with all things to enjoy. Instruct those who are rich, or rather have possessions in this life, not to be arrogant or to put their hope on the uncertainty of wealth, but instead put your hope in God, who richly provides us with all things for our enjoyment. What a timely and helpful word. Scripture is always relevant. You and I don't have to prop it up to make it applicable. Like, this will preach. And we need this word from our brother Paul and from the power of the risen Jesus, the Holy Spirit. So let's pray before we dig in together for just a moment. God, open the eyes and the ears of our hearts to be faithful, to not just be hearers of the word, but be doers of the word. And for anyone in this room, Paul's talking about wealth or possessions. For any of us in this room, when it comes to the entirety of our lives, our time, our talents, and our treasures, for anybody who's doing well in that area, let this be an encouragement not to grow weary in doing those things well. And if there's anybody in this room who's had a similar experience to me, like realizing, like, I don't want to squander what God's given me any longer, then convict and encourage. Help us to leave here being one step closer, looking to be more like your son, and more like the church that you've called us to be in the city of Nashville for your glory and for the joy of your people. And we pray this in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said, amen. Well, we're going to walk through several verses out of this chapter over the next several weeks. And if you're curious, you know, the month of July, why would we focus on stewardship? Why would we focus on these earthly treasures that Timothy is talking about? Hey, listen, I want to be an encourager to you today. I want to brag on you. I want to encourage you. Like, this church has been growing in the area of Paul talks about wealth or riches. In the year 2020, when we went through the pandemic, listen, I know that many of you, you lost income or you lost your jobs completely, and others of us in our congregation took pay cuts or reworked our budget. And even when the globe and the members of this congregation were being squeezed tightly, we've existed for 8 years, but in 2020, it was one of our strongest giving and tithing years. Now, why would I tell you that? Is to say that you demonstrated, let me encourage you and brag on you, you demonstrated that even when we were being squeezed by the circumstances of the world, this congregation grew in the area of trusting the Lord Jesus with what He's put in our hands, what He's put in our bank accounts. Listen, a lot of times you hear the cliche like, our best days are ahead of us. You ever heard a leader or a pastor say something like that? We've existed 8 years coming up in September. At this mark in our history, there's been great things that have been happening. But a couple of months ago, as you know, we purchased nearly 2 acres of property right around the corner in our neighborhood. We don't have to leave the neighborhood. We can grow into our forever home. We're going to add 10,000 square feet of preschool, children, and student space. There's going to be grass on that playground. Anybody first-time guest here, and you're like, man, there's a ton of pavement. It's hard to park and get in here. Like, God is answering even the most basic prayer request that we've had. And when we open that new facility and finish our lease here next year and move in there, like, one of the things I'm super mindful of is how God's faithfulness to us, demonstrated by you and all of us together trusting the Lord with the resources, provided the ability for us to purchase that and to put ourselves in a position to that. So I just want to tell you, over the last couple of years and the last several months, I've seen this congregation growing in the area of finances, if you will. We talk about time, talents, and treasures. Paul's talking directly about wealth or about income. And so he's coming at this text from a very encouraging way. There was nothing of crisis, as I can tell, in regards to finances in the church in Ephesus, but he encourages them. Keep this in mind. And that's my heart and posture to us today and for the next several weeks. Like, things are going well. We are growing in this area of trust in the Lord in this way. And listen, let's don't stop now. Now's not the time to become complacent in that. We want to be faithful with this. And you may have read this just a moment ago, and you know, Paul's talking to Christians, and he says very specifically, let me instruct those of you who are wealthy. And you may hear this, and maybe intuitively you're like, okay, I could fit in that category. And if you want to do your own self-evaluation, maybe you might compare or think through like the size of your resources or cars or your home or townhome or whatever it may be, or your ability to have the disposable income to travel or do whatever. And if you're like, you know, that's where I am in life. Like, Paul's not preaching against that, nor am I. But this is a challenge, an encouragement. I tell you where I've been. When I was in college, I heard a pastor preach this. I'm like, he is not talking to this brother. I ain't got 2 nickels to rub together. And what money I do have, I want to love Jesus with a tithe, but like, I really want to go out to eat on Friday night with the guys. I know I'm probably not the only one who's ever wrestled with that big spiritual decision. But here's the deal. Before you're like, this isn't for me. It's okay if you feel that way, but I want to tell you something. You know, one of the things that you and I need to realize is how fortunate and blessed we are. Well, you know, just as a people to be born in this country and to live in North America, you know, no matter what study you consult, many studies would tell you that where we live in the United States, our income and our wealth, if you will, compared to global peers is incredible. One study said the global median income is around $20,000 for your average person around the globe. The American median income, according to one study, it's just one study, is about $51,000. One study said even the poorest 20% of Americans who feel like they don't have a lot of disposable income, which that's legit if you feel that way, if I feel that way, but the poorest 20% of Americans still have more purchasing power than nearly 22 other global nations, including Mexico, Korea, Sweden, Australia, and others. It's a matter of perspective, isn't it? The boys and I watched a documentary about a person moving from Serbia to the United States, and they're like, what was the coolest thing about getting to the United States? And he's like, when I got here, I called my family, and I'm like, they have so much chocolate here. We were surprised by that, and the person said, what do you mean? And this professional athlete said, like, in Serbia, you go to the store for chocolate, you get the one chocolate in the whole country. He said, I call my family, and I'm like, they got white chocolate, they got dark chocolate, they got chocolate with almonds, they got chocolate with cherries. Like, they have so many chocolates. He goes, I love America. This is phenomenal. And one of the realities about going on a mission trip or going to a different nation or place is you see the beauty and the creativity of how God has shaped all of us around the globe, different skin colors, different ethnicities, different languages and dialects. But I will tell you this, if you go visit Kosovo, like we're going to do perhaps next year, or you go somewhere else similar to this example, or Guatemala, like a team's going in a few weeks, you just become aware, hang with me here, we could all benefit from this, you just become aware that you and I have access to a lot of things our global peers do not. I only illustrate the obvious to say when Paul says, instruct those who are wealthy, there may be some of us in the room, that is, among your peers in America, your story. And you don't need to apologize for that, but hear this instruction. I want to challenge all of us, there's something here for all of us to learn because we have all been richly blessed in one way or another because of where we live and the city we're in. So I'm just simply illustrating the obvious that Paul's like, everybody's got something to learn from this. And what's the first thing Paul wants us to know? A healthy, growing church in the city of Nashville, like what's the first thing he wants us to know about how we handle the resources God's put in our hand? Well, look at what he says here in verse 17. If you got your Bible open, look with me. Do not be arrogant about the resources that you have. And don't by any means set your hope on the uncertainty of wealth. Don't be arrogant about what you have and do not, like, and I don't think we do this willingly, but we slowly get comfortable. We slowly start to like more and more of a good thing, whether it be income or net worth or experiences or trips and all that. And again, there's nothing wrong with that. But we slowly start to put our joy and our contentment and our hope in those things. Do not be arrogant about such things. I've never met anybody at Avenue South that's like, Aaron, do you know how much money I make? Do you have any idea how much money I make? How many cars I have? Did you know, like, we have a summer home on 30A? Like, I've never met anybody that's done that. You are an incredibly humble congregation, unless you're totally not humble the other 167 hours of the week, and then you and Jesus just need to do business, okay? But I don't sense that. But here's where it creeps up. One of the things that we need to realize, Psalm 24:1 says, the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. James 1:16-17, do not be deceived, my brothers and sisters. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, who does not change like the shifting shadows. Every good and perfect gift is from above. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it. When the Lord blesses you with something, do you return your gratitude to Him first, or do you post a picture on social media so others will know? I don't know, man. I'll just be honest with you. Somebody recently offered me and the boys club-level tickets to see a Major League Baseball team. My boys fight over their rival teams, but on this team, I said, we'll go. You're so generous. That's awesome. We'll go. And this guy said, hey, listen, here's what you need to know. They're in a special section. We happen to be season ticket members. Since we're not using them, you can use them. Like, there's a special gate you can go in. You get in before everybody else. When you get up to the club level, no matter how early you get there, you get all the food you can eat. Hey, anybody else go to one of them deals and you're like, they are going to totally lose money on this brother. You can get all the food you want. Your restrooms, the restroom line for the common person is 20 deep. Yours, sir, just walk right in and walk right out and grab food. And I was like, man, this is awesome. And I'll be honest with you. I took a picture. I asked somebody, would you take a picture of me and the boys with the field behind us? And I immediately kind of wanted to post it. And I just going to confess, it wasn't to be like, hello, church family. Look at God's faithfulness to us and these wonderful relationships I'm fostering with the boys, creating a memory that'll last forever and is more important than possessions. My first thought was, what an awesome experience this guy's having. And in some way, I wanted you to know I was having that experience. So again, it may not be as obvious as like, I have income, I have wealth, you have resources. It may be as subtle as the humble brag. It may be something like that. Here's just what I want to tell you. With the stuff and the experiences you have, and by the way, don't hate me if I post a picture later about this experience, okay? But here's the deal. Are you okay if God is the only one who knows what He's given you? Is that good enough if God's the only one who knows how much money is in your bank account? Do you need somebody else's gratification for that? I don't know. One of the first things we should do, and let me just say this, when the Lord blesses us and puts something in our hand, times, talents, and treasures, and we recognize it. So maybe today you haven't ever done this, and you haven't done it in a while. Great opportunity to go home or before you leave the church and say, I just want to thank you. I want to acknowledge that every good and perfect gift is from above. And our brother James said, don't be deceived about that. I want to return gratitude. You have been exceedingly good to me. And I'm going to be honest with you. There have been times if you're in this room and maybe let's say you are working. We have so many hard workers in our church. You're diligent with your career, and maybe you're grinding, and you're working 40 or 50 hours a week, and you're trying to get out of debt, and you're doing a lot, and you just don't feel like there's not a whole lot here, Aaron. I felt that way once, and I shared that out loud. I hate it when I think out loud. I shared that in a small group, and one guy said, would you be content if all that you ever got out of life is that God sent his son Jesus to die for you? If Jesus is all you had, would that be enough? I felt a little bit like, in front of him, I felt like, what do you say to that? I mean, what do you say? No, I kind of want a few other things as well. Like, what do you say to that? He heard it like, you and I both know this intuitively. If all God ever did for us is send Jesus to die for us, so we don't spend an eternity separated from him in a literal place called hell, like we owe him everything. And so one of the things Paul wants us to do is like, right, like, isn't he good? Isn't he good? And so sometimes we have some stuff. Other times we have more than at other parts of our life. But isn't he just so good? Isn't he so good to all of us? So one of the first ways you remain humble, because James says that the Father opposes the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. Everybody in this room today, before the sun sets, should say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And just, can I ask you to do this? Would you make a list of 3 to 5 things that you need to thank him for that you haven't thanked him for in a month, you haven't thanked him for in a year, you haven't thanked him for in 10 years? Thank you, Jesus, for these things. I'm going to suggest to you, if you start with 3 to 5, you'll end up with 10 to 20 if you keep running with it. But a heart of gratitude keeps you humble and soft that you realize where it's come from. And let me tell you why that matters. I'll tell you why that matters. It helps safeguard your heart so that you don't slowly let your heart become numb and find joy and contentment in only what you have in your bank account or only what you have materialistically. I don't know if you saw this in the text. One of the things Paul says is, God, who richly provides us with all things to enjoy, please do not hear me preaching against things. Please do not hear me saying you shouldn't go to the ball game and sit in club level and look at the guy next to you and be like, how you doing? I'm having a great time. It's not what I'm saying. If you're a foodie and you post pictures of your food and you're like, oh, what a great, you know, Lady Bird Taco was just rocked this week or whatever it is. And you are like, I'm not going to post this. I'm going to feel guilty if my pastor sees it. He says I shouldn't brag. But man, post it. Just enjoy it. Paul isn't preaching against things, and nor am I. Did you see what it said? God gives us these things to enjoy. So enjoy what you have. Enjoy what he's put in your hand, the time, talents, and the treasures. But he did start off by talking about wealth, and you do know that Jesus talked about resources and finances more than just about anything else. You do know that, right, in the gospel accounts? Because oftentimes what's going on in our hearts is revealed in what we care about. And so a lot of times if that's what we unintentionally, like our joy comes from that, also make a list of this. Can you do this? Make a list of like the top 5 to 6 things you care about most that you have. Your house, your car, whatever it may be. Like if you lost all of those, would that also steal your joy? If you lost those things, would you lack your identity and your contentment? Here's what I want you to know. Paul said, don't fall asleep and don't become numb. Keep your heart alive and soft and moldable by the Holy Spirit. That starts with gratitude. It starts with acknowledging to Jesus. Everything has come from your hand. But one of the things that we need to be mindful of is he says, look, this life is going to fade. It's going to pass. And you do know when you come to the end of it, I do believe our brother James said it a little better. You do know at the end of life, like you leave it to somebody else, right? Like, so don't put your heart in this. I mean, James said it this way, if it's helpful to you. James said it this way. Come now, you who say today or tomorrow, we will travel to such and such city and spend a year there and do business and make a profit. Yet you don't know what tomorrow will bring or what your life will be. For you're like a vapor and a mist in this life. Instead, you should say, if the Lord wills it, we will live and do this or do that. But as it is, you boast. And when you boast, it's arrogance because you don't know what tomorrow will bring. Paul, James, so many other godly women and men emphasize this throughout the full complement of Scripture. Enjoy it. Find some measure of contentment, not ultimate contentment. But know this, when you get to the end of the life here on earth and you slip into eternity, or if we're alive when Jesus returns, I mean, those things will cease to exist. In our family, we are moving my 93-year-old grandmother from Alabama to Nashville. And we just helped her move out of her house where she has been living for some 50 years and the last 20 without my grandfather. I mean, think about boxing up what you own, right? Now listen, I mean, you know this. Many of you in this room, you're caring for aging parents. You've done this for others. So my story is not unique to me. But you know what? You sit there and it's very visceral. You start thinking like, hey, if I'm going to borrow James. If the Lord wills it, maybe got 25, 30 years ahead of me. What about you? Median age in America is about 82 for a man right now. You might have 30 years. You might have 40 years. I sat there being like, this moment's coming for all of us. And one of the biggest challenges she had was paring down she's such a classy woman. Grew up in the Depression when my grandfather said, like, to have an orange for Christmas was something special. That's all they got. And had to pare down her wardrobe to fit it all in a smaller closet in the assisted living community she's moving to. And she said in the process, she said, I want you to do a favor for me. She said, I want you to preach my funeral. And I said, okay. I said, one of the greatest privileges of my life that you would ever ask me that, and you can count on it. What an honor. I mean, in the middle of me standing there and processing, like, this is coming for all of us. This is where it all goes. In the middle of my grandmother saying, I know the finality of all of this. And she's good with saying it. Like, if that's where it all goes, it's so good when a brother or a sister who's walked with Christ just a little bit longer than you have speaks sobering, encouraging words to say, a dispatch from the future here, folks. What you do have, enjoy it. But leverage it so that when you get to that moment, you won't feel like you've squandered that influence. So what are you going to invest those things in? Paul talks about resources. He talks about wealth. He talks about income. So we talk about time, talents, and treasures. What are you doing with the finances that God has blessed you with? Now, if you feel like you don't have a lot of resources, that's understandable. We don't all have the same resources. We all, if you're a follower of Jesus, we all have the same availability. So there's a story in Scripture about the widow's mite, a widow who walked up to the temple and she threw in just a couple of coins, and a Pharisee, a religious leader, was like, at least I'm not like her. Look at my offering. But she gave out a great sacrifice, Jesus said, because that's just about all she owned. When my other grandmother passed away, the family started getting letters. Like, we started getting her statements that she would give to ministries. And I like to give, like, I want to see a huge impact in this place. I'm going to leverage things. My grandmother, we started getting receipts and things where she gave $2.50 to this ministry to advance the gospel in Central America. And $5.50 a month over here so that people who are Jewish, who've never heard about Jesus or haven't believed him as the Christ, that they might hear the gospel. I mean, look, if you counted it up, all those things that came in, it might not amount to $1,000 over the course of 12 months. But I'm going to suggest to you a life well lived, not squandering a depression era child who grew up to be an adult to say, I'm going to invest every bit of what I got for the cause of other people hearing about Jesus or at least having the chance to accept or reject. I think about those stories. It's very much on my heart and my mind. Paul says, one of the things we need to be mindful of is not to put our hope in things that are of this world, but things that are eternal, to enjoy. When he says, set your hope on God, he's saying, enjoy God and then leverage the things of this life to make him known. To make him known. Now, I bragged on you about a few minutes ago. you've been leveraging the things of this world that the Lord's put in your hand, put in your bank account to fund the advancement of the gospel. There were a lot of people in our community who fell on hard times that are not followers of Jesus, that are not going to join our church, perhaps they're not going to join any church, but we got phone calls, we got emails of people in the community who said, I need help. And we never asked them, are you a member? Do you have any intent to join our membership process? You're going to go to Guatemala in the fall of 2022? Like, we never did that to them. We're called to love the people in our community, whether they believe what we do or not, to serve them and to bless them. You've done that in tangible ways in the past. You're doing that now. So listen, don't grow weary in doing good. That pops up a couple times in the New Testament. Don't grow weary in doing good if you're trusting the Lord with your resources. For some of us in the room, it may be like, you know what? The things of this world have too much of a hold on my heart and they arrest my affections in an unhealthy way. This brother quit watching college football avidly some 10 years ago because I let what 18 to 22-year-olds do on a playing field ruin my afternoon. I wish I were more mature. For others of us, it's soccer or whatever it may be. Like, that had a grip on something of the world, had a grip on my heart that wasn't healthy. So maybe it's just that for you this morning. I need to find joy and hope in Jesus more than this. But let me put a challenge before of us. Don't grow weary in doing good. We have continued to grow in faithful stewardship. We can always grow to become more like Christ. So maybe it's an opportunity for all of us to say, I want to be a really good steward of what God's given me to make Jesus known. And it's okay to say, Lord, I want to have great joy in that. Would you show me opportunities? Would you show me opportunities for that? So let me reread this verse again with the reminder and the exhortation. We all can find something applicable and all something life-giving from this. Those who are rich in the present age, don't be arrogant. Don't find your joy and contentment in those things. God's given you those things, so enjoy them. However, put your hope and find your joy and your ultimate commitment in Jesus, who's always certain. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And he will provide unending, everlasting, never-changing, unshakable joy and hope. Let me encourage you to bow your head and close your eyes for just a minute. It may be super helpful for us to take a next practical step with this text. And so if you are not a follower of Jesus Christ, and I've done this at times in my life, if you have tried to find joy and contentment in the things of this world, and it's just fleeting, then let me encourage you to trust Jesus for that. If that means you need to call on the name of Jesus over the next couple of minutes, let me encourage you to do that. To, as we say, to invite Jesus into your life, to surrender to how Jesus says is a better, more fulfilling, eternally significant way to live. We believe that is found through faith and belief in Jesus Christ. Maybe you want to do that this morning. Maybe things are going really well, and in your life, like if you were going to look at your own life with a critical eye, you'd say, I really am trying to be the person God's called me to be. I'm looking more like Christ. I'm growing. I find great contentment in Jesus. Great. Never a better time to say, I just want to remain faithful to Jesus and find my hope in him. Because then you can enjoy all the things he blesses you with and they don't own you. They don't dictate your affection. So maybe you just want to return gratitude to him and say, keep teaching me. Keep working in my heart. But then finally, maybe it is for those of us that were like, you know, it's never too late to become the man or woman in Christ we might have been. This is a sobering wake-up call. Then you tell Jesus, I do not want to squander what you've blessed me with. I know I've been blessed to bless others in Jesus' name. So then confess that and ask him to do a work in your heart. God's up to something in the city of Nashville. He's up to something in our church. Our best days are ahead. We want to be humble and faithful and obedient as he brings himself glory in our city. So take the next 60 seconds, pray for whatever it is you might need in the next few moments. And then Nicole will ask us to stand and to sing in response to this text and how we might need to apply it in our lives. But let's pray together for the next minute or so.
Let's stand together and sing.
Ask you to have a seat for just a minute before we conclude our time together in corporate worship. I want us to continue worship by giving in just a moment. We do that because we see in the book of Acts, that's what the first church did, the local church should do. And obviously on the coattails of a sermon like this, we bring our offerings to the Lord to say we want you to use this in whatever way you see fit in our community. And so in just a moment, you can give in the baskets that are going to be passed. You can give online through the church website. You can text the number 623-623 with any amount you can give. Most of you know that. There's any number of ways you can give, but let's use what God's given us to advance His name and serve and bless others. One of the things I do want to share with you is I was privileged to preach at our Brentwood campus last week while our senior pastor's away on sabbatical. Obviously, a lot going on in our culture. A lot had happened that Friday before Sunday. I was not in person with you, but I shared a video to set up our guest preacher for the day, Keith Holloway. But also, I shared just a few comments that I so wish last Sunday I could have been in person with you. What I want to tell you is this. One of the things I'm always mindful of Christians is that we are always, hopefully, gracious and compassionate when we are passionate and even advocates about issues that are at the core of the gospel. So let me challenge you, in any issue that you are having a dialogue with, a coworker, friend, neighbor, or that you're posting about on social media, which is not the best place for deep theological, like, scriptural conversations. You should take those offline, but always do it with grace and compassion. those of us who have experienced the mercy of God should be the first to offer mercy to others. And that pertains, yes, to the discussion in our culture about life and conception. I want you to know something. We are so grateful for anything that would happen in our nation that would advance the dignity and the advocacy for the unborn. We are. Look, hear me. That's not a political issue. I'm not a political pastor. I don't do that. That's at the core of Psalm 139 and countless other scriptures. And we need to preach that. We need to model that. Here's what I am concerned about that I do want to tell you. One of the criticisms of churches anywhere in America is that, like, we really stump for that when we're begging and pleading for a child to be brought to term and for a mother in crisis pregnancy to have their child. And then one of the criticisms, I don't think it's fair, but like one of the criticisms is that a lot of churches do not support and help. Like, what if there is a single mother? Like, how's the church going to help? You guys haven't done that well. I've heard that one personally. So here's what I want you to know. For decades through our broader church family, Brentwood Baptist, and for years in this congregation, people have been passionate about foster care and adoption and orphan care. And I'm looking around the room and I see those of you who've walked that journey, you're on that journey, and you are simply saying, we want to love God and love people and do this well because this is at His heart. And we're going to be, you're doing well, we're going to be more serious about that than ever. One aspect, though, that I do want us to continue working toward, and one aspect we really got to get really good at in the years ahead, not that it hasn't been important, is when there is a pregnant mother in crisis. She doesn't know where to turn. She's afraid she's going to be ostracized by her family or judged by others for showing up in a church and saying, this is my story. We've got to do everything we can to support and encourage and resource that mom, that child. And if a dad is involved, a lot of circumstances there, I'll own that, I'll acknowledge that. But if he's involved too, to want God's best for him, we got to do that well. And that's why, listen, you've been giving to help fund one of our ministry partners. Emma Phillips, would you come join me? Emma is on staff at Hope Clinic for Women. And the reason I would bring her up here is because I've been thinking all week and reaching out to our ministry partners. We have been doing this. How do we structure this for the next several months and years? So Emma, there may be somebody in the room who doesn't know what Hope Clinic is all about. I don't want to ever assume that. Do you mind just giving a broad kind of explanation of what Hope Clinic is doing and your role there?
Sure. So to sum it up in one sentence, Hope Clinic exists to serve women and families in Nashville, and we exist to love mother and baby equally. And that's something that can be kind of radical in the world of crisis pregnancies. It's really easy to love a baby. They're innocent. They've never done anything to offend you. They're cuddly. They're cute. It's a lot harder to love us adults who are imperfect and who have baggage and who have, you know, mistakes that we've made. And we really want to be sure that we're serving these mothers that come through our door with non-judgmental love, and by surrounding them with a village of people who are there to be their community, whether they have family there to support them or not, whether the father is in the picture or not. And we do that through offering parenting classes. We offer material support. We offer the physical items that they may need, baby clothes, diapers, you name it. And we also offer professional counseling on a sliding scale to help with pregnancy loss or to help with past trauma or help with any of the whole host of things that these women may have gone through in their lives. We also offer relationship education for young people to help educate them on healthy relationships. And ultimately, at the heart of what we do is we want people to experience abundant life. And our church family is such a huge part of that mission. And I want to thank AvSouth and thank Brentwood Baptist for being such a great part of that story. And your mission giving comes to us, and you're one of our most fantastic partners. So very happy to be here. And I want to thank everyone for being a part of that.
So let me just do this for the sake of time. When this service is over, in just a minute, Emma's going to step out to the welcome desk, and she's there for you to get to know her. When I've had anybody from Hope Clinic come share in any Bible study I've taught or from the platform, I've had several people say, I wanted to talk to her, but I'm not going to go up and talk to her in front of everybody else because somebody will think I'm going through something. Can I just call our church never to make judgments or assumptions about what someone needs when they come forward or reach out to a ministry partner? However, if that's you and this is like very just It's a lot to deal with. We want to honor that. Here's what I'm going to ask. Everybody in this room, go say hey to Emma and grab a brochure when you leave. That way nobody's singled out. And if that's you, we love you. If there's anything this church can do, even if you come to me, sometimes this happens on any need in our community. I say, I don't know what the next step is, but I promise you this, we'll figure it out together. I'll make calls. We'll do whatever we need to do. And if that means we need to reach out to Emma, I want you to see her up here, to be familiar with her. Guys, if you're interested in being a mentor, they have a program for dads who show up at Hope Clinic with their pregnant girlfriend or their wife, and they don't know what to do. They're scared, like, men, we need you as well. So any number of ways you want to get involved, Emma's going to be out there. Emma, thank you so much for being here. I'm grateful for her. You've been doing this well. Let's get as serious as we ever have about this, okay? Let me invite our ushers to come forward, and when they come forward, know that your giving goes to support a number of things, including the great work at Hope Clinic, okay? Let's pray together. God, thank you so much for your faithfulness. We are grateful for Emma and that team there. Yes, of course, in this church, we should be involved in advocacy, and we should be involved in support and resources financially, emotionally. But partners like Hope Clinic are so good and strategic, and we have much to learn from them in this. So help our partnership to continue to grow. And we just pray right now as a church, we just pray right now for any woman who is walking this journey and needs the comfort and the peace of the Holy Spirit. We pray that in Jesus' name for every woman in our city, for every child, and for every man, and for every family. Emma's right, Lord. We want to see people flourish. So we pray that would happen in Jesus' name. Be honored in the gifts we bring in this moment. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, well, Emma's going to be making her way out to the front of the commons area. And again, thank you so much for being there. Hey, when you give, I told you earlier, when you give, you are funding the advancement of the gospel. And one of the things your giving is doing is making it possible for people to be obedient to go and share the gospel around the nations. So, in about a week, we have a team going to Guatemala. We have a team going to Guatemala. And I see Alex Rose in the back. These lights are so bright. I'm a major sweater anyway, and like they're so bright and hot. I think that's you. Come on up here. Mitch, I see you back there. Others, if you are part of this team that is going to Guatemala, would you come forward? We prayed of this team early in the 9 o'clock. We will do it again here. Alex Renfro here. Here's what I want you to know. These are three adult leaders in our church who are representative of a broader team who are giving, they're taking vacation time from work. They are giving of their own financial resources to go, and they are gearing up emotionally, mentally, and spiritually to give, give, give from the minute their boots hit the ground till they get back on the airplane to come back. They deserve our prayers, okay? Thank you for your giving. You help us make these trips affordable for everybody, but they're going to be doing a lot of ministry there that your gifts have helped purchase. So let me ask you, go ahead and stand up. This is how we will conclude. We normally sing the doxology, so I know some of you, there's a child in our church that I know is going to be offended because they love singing the doxology. So I do have one apology to make to them, but everybody else, just get over it, okay? We're going to conclude with praying for this team, okay? I'm going to ask this. As I look around the room, Wes and Candace, you're right here. Would y'all come up here? Kelsey, Jessica, would y'all come up here? Ava, Steph, y'all have been to Guatemala. Jim, would you come up here? I'm just looking. Billy, Stephanie, others. Mary Christie, anybody who knows anybody on this team, would y'all just come forward? There's something about putting a hand on a shoulder and saying, like, we love you. We're so grateful you're part of our church. I'm going to ask everybody else, would y'all pray for them? They will be leaving. You can see all this information on our social media and on the website. They'll be leaving in the next week, and so please be faithful to pray for them. Let me lead that prayer, and then we will be dismissed, okay? God, we thank you so much for your faithfulness, and this morning we thank you for the gospel of Jesus Christ. We are not naive enough to think we have it all figured out or that another nation or another beautiful, creative, talented people need us to show up to pull back that curtain. There's so much you're already at work doing in Guatemala. But what we want to be is we want to be your hands and your feet to minister and strengthen and embolden and refresh people at Clubhouse Ministries and other partners that are doing such great work on the ground. So help us to be helpful in that way. We do pray for gospel conversations. We pray for women, men, and children to come to faith in Jesus Christ in Guatemala, that many of us may only meet in heaven as a result of the next couple of weeks. We pray for Alex. Alex, God, she's doing such great work in our Next Gen ministry. And she has worked very hard with the logistics, the planning, and the spiritual preparation for this trip. Bless and strengthen her. We're grateful for her leadership in this church. For everyone that's going on this team, give them spiritual protection, safety as they travel. Bless them, and would you please raise up missionaries of the men and the women? Would there be a teenager in our church that wants to go to the mission field one day because they saw this moment of prayer, they hear stories when they get back? God, do only what you can do for your glory and for the joy of your people here in Nashville and in Guatemala City. And we pray all this in Jesus' name, and all of God's people said, amen. Amen. Have a great 4th of July weekend and holiday. We hope to see you back next Sunday.